this is Noreen Crone-Findlay from Crone-Findlay.com and toddytalkscrafts.com. And today, this video tutorial is all about how to weave a circle on the Dewberry Ridge peg loom. Dewberry Ridge looms, I just love them. They're so beautifully made. And Gary and Donna are wonderful people. Now, I wanted to show you, pardon for the wobble here, I want to show you my various and sundry earls. There's my website, www.cronefindlay.com. That's where you can order my ebooks and patterns, and please do, because if you like my free video tutorials, then I really appreciate your support by purchasing my patterns and my ebooks. And there's my blog. I post support material for the video tutorials there. And of course, if you're on my video tutorials, and I'll back up enough there so you can actually see it, then you know that earl already. And my Etsy shop, you can go there to buy my patterns and ebooks and things too. That's N. Crone-Findlay with the dash not in the Crone-Findlay, .etsy.com. And if you want to follow me on Facebook, that's how you do it. Facebook.com/Noreen Crone-Findlay Designs. And it's all smushed together with no dots or dashes or anything. So there are my earls. So let's get started. So here's the tools and equipment that you need to weave your circles on the Dewberry Ridge peg loom. Of course, you need to start by having the loom. In this case, I'm going to be working with the three row loom. And I've chosen to work with the medium size pegs because for my weft yarn, I'm going to be using quite thick yarn that is kind of a roving yarn, and I'm going to combine some hand spun with it because the roving is kind of flat and boring, so that will perk it up by having more yummy yarns in with it. The latch tool and the threading tool from Dewberry Ridge looms are just wonderful to work with. I just love them. They're very handy. And sometimes I need to use a bigger latch hook too. This is a thrift shop special. And I will show you why I use the larger latch hook. And that is when I add loops of ribbon or cord to the ends of the pegs to make it easier to use really thick warp strands. Why do I want to use thick warp strands? Because the diameter of the channel that your weft, now your weft strands are going around your weaving pegs. So that's how much empty space is going to be between your strands of, pretend my fingers are the weft strands, that's how much empty space there will be once the peg has moved out. So ideally what you want is to have warp strands that are the same thickness as the peg. And of course you couldn't possibly have a hole that's the same size as the peg because the peg would be broken. So to make it possible to use really thick warp strands, then you put cords or ribbons in a loop in them, and then you can put wadges of great thick warp strands through there. That works really well. Oh, apologies for the unsightly bandage. I had an accident yesterday with a very sharp knife, and ouch. Okay, so we've got our pegs, and I'm also going to show you how to use the loom as a warping board for cutting your warp strands. For that, of course, you do need to have a ruler or measuring tape. You will also need to use I've got two of the larger size because I'm going to need to use both rows, the front and the back row of the peg loom when I'm using them as my warping board. So hopefully, and I mentioned scissors. Oh, you'll also need, at some point, you will need to have a darning or craft needle. So that's, oh, and did I mention this stuff, the sticky grip fabric is really handy. I like to have my looms sitting on that so that the loom doesn't move around. I actually do that on all of my table looms. Okay, so I'm going to move to the next segment. So I will turn the camera off and I'll get myself set up so I can show you how to tie on the strands of yarn onto the, those ribbons on to make the loops on the weaving pegs. Because I'm going to be weaving a circle that is 7 inches in diameter, that means that I'm going to work, we'll be weaving on the radius of the circle. So, of course, I only need to weave sections that are 3.5 inches wide, which is 5 pegs. So that's how many loops I'm going to tie on today. Now, the length of the ribbons is actually about 8 inches. Let me just check that. Seven and a half inches or so. So what I'm going to do is I'll use my threading tool and insert that through the hole. I'll then pull the ribbon through the hole on the peg, and I'll pull it up so the ends are equal. Then I'm going to pick up 4 more sticks because I've found that when I tie over 4 sticks, that that makes the loop reach the end of the stick just beautifully. So my first half of my first knot is going to be the surgeon's knot, which means I take it through once. Then I'm going to go through the loop one more time, and I will pull up quite tightly. A little hard to do that when you have a gammy thumb. Okay, and now the second half of the knot, I go over and under, and whoops, like I said, gammy thumb, clumsy. Okay, pull up, then I will pull those extra pegs out. And now to secure this, the knot, what I'm going to do is make an overhand knot. And I find the easiest way to make an overhand knot is to place my latch hook on top, and I take the latch hook, go under so that the ends go over the top, and then slip them over, and then put the ends into the hook and close the latch and pull up and pull the ends through and pull them tight so that your knot is not going to come undone. Pull, pull, pull. And then you can trim your ends off. So I'm going to finish tying all the other loops onto the rest of my pegs and come back to you when that's done. So we're going to do a little circle math, and I'm going to talk about how pi and pi are part of the whole process of weaving circles on the peg loom. And I don't know if you noticed before, but I had little numbers up in the corner here, and I've decided to number each section because that makes it easier for me to edit, and it also makes it easier if you need to back up, then you can just watch for those numbers and see where you're having to back up to. So now for a little circle math, and we're going to talk about pi and pi. And why do we need to talk about pi and pi? Well, pi is very helpful when we want to figure out the length of the warp strands. You can draw a circle and then just measure around it to find out your circumference, but that does mean you have to find your compass, which not everybody has one close at hand. And just a quick little formula is going to help you so much, because your circumference, that is the distance around the outside edge of your circle, is pi, and pi is 3.14 with a gazillion other numbers on the end, times the diameter. So the diameter, of course, is the distance across the circle at the very center point of the circle. So today I want to weave a circle that's about 7 inches in diameter. So I could be very precise and get out my calculator and go 3.14 times 7 is, you know, 21, da 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 da, 22, da 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 da. And I go, well, it's kind of 22 inches. So I know that I need my warp strands to be at least 22 inches long. But, of course, that would just meet my warp ends here at this point when they've gone all the way around the outside, because we're going to weave our pie in a pie. And that wouldn't give me anything to tie off my ends and weave in my ends. So I need to add a wee little bit. So I'm going to say, well, 22 inches, and let's give us, oh, at least another 4 inches. So 26 inches, oh, maybe let's even say 27 inches. So, okay, so 27 inches will take me around and give me a little spare, but I need to multiply that times 2. Because I want my warp strands to be folded in half. When you fold your warp strands in half, you get just the ease of advancing your weft strands down them is just wonderful. So we're going to double it, and we're going to have our warp strands in half. And so in order to make those warp strands, what we're going to do is we're going to take our, I guess for this tape measure would be easier, but I've got a measuring stick here. So 14 inches. So I was saying 27 inches. But gee, if I put one peg in here and one peg in here, that gives me 14 inches. And look at this. If I put the pegs, oh, need to go up a bit because there. All right. If we go up a bit, you can see I've got the one peg, the big peg on the back one and the medium one on the front one. And I'm going to put the medium on the front and the other big one on the back. And almost by magic, this is kind of accidentally, I get almost perfectly. It's going to be a bit more than I need. So, you know, what I could do is take out that peg, and I am going to have to do an edit to move my camera up for the actual warping process, so you can see a little better that I have two pegs down here and just the one down here. And I'll also go get a tape measure. So I'm going to turn off the camera, go get a tape measure, so I can show you that we're just in quite a happy ballpark place. You know, if I had wanted the warp strands to be shorter, I could move this third peg up here, Or if I had wanted it to be longer, I could put the fourth one in and move this one all the way down. And I could even put pegs in the middle and just have a more complicated warp path. But it works really well as a warping board, and it's so compact and it's right there for you. So yay for the peg loom as a warping board. Okay, time to stop and go get the tape measure and move the camera. Here we go, camera's moved and I've got a measuring tape. Now, we wanted to have about 27 inches for our warp strands times two. So here we go. This is, let me see, that is 29. So I'm going to come back one peg to 28. I'd rather err on the side of extra length than to go too short. So our warp path, each warp strand is going to go around these three pegs. I'll start here, it'll come around the corner, go back, and come here. And that will be, the finished length will be about 56 inches. Because remember when we were doing our math, we have our diameter times pi is about 22 plus a little bit. So that's 28 times 2 is about 56 inches, which is perfect. Now, because I want my warp strands to be quite fat, I'm going to make each set of warp strands, I'll probably use at least 6 strands of yarn in each warp bundle. So each one of those yarn strands is going to have to be the 56 inches long. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to pull the yarn from the outside of the ball and the inside of the ball so that I am using 2 strands at a time. And what I'm going to do is, because I want to have at least 6 or 8 strands in each bundle of warp strands, because remember I want a nice fat set of warp strands, I'm going to go around my warp pegs. You know, because they tend to pull in, I'm going to move that one back, because I'm kind of staying. I'm also going to pull my yarn off my ball quite a ways, because I find the weight of the ball of yarn is pulling back against the warp pegs, and that's going to make the warp strands be shorter, just because the weight pulling on the warp strands is going to pull back. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go around my warping path is, whoops, here we go, hold on at this end. My warping path is each strand of this from the starting point back to the starting point is one, that's the length of each set in the warp strands. But I want to have at least 6 or so strands in my warp bundle. So I'm going to go around another time, and this gives me 4 warp strands in my bundle of warp strands for the first peg. And I'm going to go around again and pull up on my ball of yarn so that I'm not having I don't want any tension coming off of that ball of yarn at all, because I don't want my warp strands getting shorter on me. So you can see now That's a nice thick bundle of warp. Beautiful. So what I'm going to do then is I'm going to snip the yarn from the ball and lift this off the peg and snip, and then I will take one set of ends . Even them up and take them through one of my loops of ribbon, and I'll catch the other ends up, hold my ends together, and the fold of the yarn is at the knot in the warp strands, in that ribbon. And then that's one peg done. So I'll do the same thing for the next one. I'm going to pull up a whole bunch of yarn so that there's no tension on the ball, starting at my starting peg number one, around to the end, and back is once, twice, and three times. There we go. There's the warp strands for my next peg. And again, lift that off. Take my ends through the ribbon, and bring them up to the ends of the other one. Take the knot from the ribbon inside the fold. You want that pretty much to be covered when you're advancing your warp. Okay, so I just noticed I'm running out of batteries, so I have to go change my batteries. So I'm going to finish warping the rest of my pegs, and when I come back to you, we can start weaving. When we're weaving a circle, the warp is the pi part, that's the pi pi, and the weft is the pi part, the slices or wedges of pi. Each we are weaving, this is our center point, and that is the left-hand peg, and the point on the circumference for the radius is the right-hand point. And what we're doing to weave these wedges is we're going to weave from the center point out to the circumference. And we're going to do that a couple of times, a couple of rows, and then on all five, and then we're going to go on all just four, then three, then two, then just one. And then we'll advance these down. These rows will go pushed. It's a triangle, you can see. They'll get pushed down the weft strand, warp strands, and then we'll do the whole thing again. And what you end up with is it turns a corner because you keep weaving these pie shapes. So you're weaving your pie shape and then advancing it. And I'm going to be weaving the pie shapes all in one color today, but you can certainly, as you do each of your pie pieces, here I've been pretty random about the pie wedges. I find for most times when I weave a circle, it's actually more of a hexagon, to be perfectly honest, because I find that six wedges usually work really well in weaving circles on the Dubray Ridge peg loom. And I'm just weaving a small circle of 7 inches, but you can weave your entire, the entire width of your loom to make a larger circle if you're weaving rugs or a mat for on the chair, like a chair cushion. And so you can make your circles whatever size you want, small or, you know, go full size of the loom. So we're going to start weaving. And like I said before, you can use thin yarn. You'll need to make more rows with thin yarn, with thick yarn, or with roving or fabric strips, you'll make fewer rows. Looking at the angle of the camera, I think I'm going to stop and change the angle so that you'll be able to see more clearly what I'm doing. I'll be back in a second for the next segment. When I was asking Gary and Donna to design a whole new gorgeous peg loom, one of the things I asked for was to have longer pegs so that I could see more of my weaving vertically on the held in place on the weaving sticks before I advance the warp. And so that's why they have the lovely 6-inch tall pegs, which a lot of other peg looms don't come that way. And having the taller pegs is really nice. Now, I've combined some hand-spun yarn with roving. Each row, because the roving, the commercial roving is a nice color, but it's kind of dull. So each row advances from the right-hand side, which is the outside of the circle, to the center of the circle, which is the left-hand side. Remember, this is the radius of the circle. We don't have, the center of the circle gets quite compressed because it has to be pulled in really hard. So we don't have a lot of space to weave in ends at the center. So I like to leave my ends on the circumference end, which is the right-hand side. And so I start my rows from right, working left, and come back. Now, because I'm not sure, we're going to weave over under, because I'm not sure how much this yarn is going to compress, I'm not sure if I'm going to work 3 rows or possibly more in each section of the wedge. Remember that wedge that I'm going to weave is going to be a triangle shape. And I'm going to weave that triangle by doing multiple rows on all 5, then on all 4, then 3, 2, and 1, and that will give me my triangle. Now, I'm thinking that does squish down quite a bit, so I'll see how 3 rows look. Here's my second row. I'll see how 3 rows look, and if I think that 4 rows across the pegs is going to work better, then that's what I'll do. See, it does squish down quite resoundingly. So that's 3 rows. I think in each section of the triangle, I'm going to weave 4 rows. Using finer pegs, and I can often, depending on the thickness of the yarn, sometimes 3 rows is enough, but sometimes you need more. So we're going to go with 4 in this, for this particular circle. Okay. And now we're just going to work on 3 of the sticks. Your sticks really do have a tendency to pull in, so every once in a while just get them to pull back out. If you find that you're weaving tighter and tighter and tighter, stop and maybe undo some and carry on going much more with a lighter touch, because you don't want to be pulling in your weaving sticks at all, because advancing the weft then just is a nightmare. So now I've done 3 rows on 3 sticks. I have to do 1 more row. Remember, a row is moving from the outside to the inside and back to the out. from right to left, back out. So that way, both sides of each stick are covered. And so now four rows just on two pegs. That's two, three, and four. And now on my last peg, I will do four quite generous, not loosey-goosey, but certainly not tight, wraps around the one peg. So we've now woven our first wedge in the circle. And looking at this, it's possible that I may need to weave more than six wedges. It's possible. We'll see how this all unfolds. Now I'm going to advance the weft strands down the warp. I've lifted my pegs off of the loom, and normally I do this with the pegs. I hold them against my thigh and then I just ease them out and use this little tool to coax them out. But for filming, it's easier if I do everything on the desktop, although it does make it a little complicated to work around the camera and everything, but we'll see how this goes. So when I'm advancing the warp, I make sure that my knots are well and truly inside, and I plunk my left hand down, and with my right hand, I don't rotate as much as sort of snug, you know, just kind of nestly snuggle the weft down off of the peg and onto the warp strands. There we go. And you just do that with each of your warp strands. Each of your weaving sticks moving the weft onto the warp strands. So I like to make sure I kind of keep, I don't like to pull my pegs too far out. So I just like the weaving to be kind of close to the very end of the stick, and not, because otherwise you can get a bulge of warp strands, and I don't think it's that big a deal, but I don't know, I find it's kind of easier if I don't have that. So just nestle, snuggle, and out it comes perfectly. So what I'll do then is I'll take my little comb tool and I'll just spread my wefts a little bit. I don't want a whole lot of warp strands showing at the top. Then I'm going to put my weaving sticks back onto my loom and get started with the next wedge. So you can see what you have here. You really are playing with geometry when you're weaving a circle, because look what you've woven is that triangle, and that edge, the long edge of the triangle, was here and it's now here. When you start your next wedge or the next triangle, you see your warp strands are going behind the outside peg. So you're going to take it over, which is the same as if you were taking it around that first peg, and just hold it down with your finger and then go across. Whoops, I didn't take the hand spun with me. There we go. Now, I could have easily changed colors and to do a multicolor circle, but I want this one to be all the same color. So I'm going to work it all in one color. So we worked four rows across all five pegs. So this is going to be our second peg. triangle. You can see I'm working very, very loosely. I'm not compressing. I'll squish my weft down, but I never pull on my weft strand when I'm weaving in and out. So always, always go with a very light touch. So then we're going to go four rows on the four pegs. So that's one, because remember we're working from the outside towards the center and we want our pivot point. So we want the least amount of weaving at the center. And that's why we work so that the most amount of weaving is at the outside edge of the pegs, because that's where the circumference of the circle is traveling around. And now what you can do too, if you want a circle that's got a larger radius than your loom, that's not a problem. Just weave straight bands, and you can angle them in by doing this triangle technique if you want, and then stitch the narrow bands around the outside edge of your circle to make your circle larger and to add another decorative element to it. You can make your circles as small as you want on your loom. You don't, as you can see, I mean, I'm making just a 7-inch circle on this loom. And 1, 2, 3. And you don't always, you know, you don't always have to work the actual dimensions of your loom. So the size of your loom really doesn't inhibit you in any way. Okay, now we're just going to go on the three for four rows, and pretty quickly we will have our second, so that's 1, 2, 3, we'll have our second wedge done. So what I think I'll do is I will finish weaving and moving all four, all six of the wedges down and see if that does make the full circle. If I need an extra one, I'll come back and let you know. So I'll see you when I have finished all at least six of the triangles and advanced them down the warp. I'll be back. Okay, so I've woven all six wedges now and taken it off the loom, and it doesn't look very circular, does it? Eek! Well, that's okay, because what's going to happen is it's going to get encouraged to become circular. Now, of course, at the center, I have lots of extra warp strands. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to pull up quite hard on those. And you know, if you want to be frugal and save your extra warp for your next project, then just keep working your, especially like these ones at the center, you don't use very much warp at all, so you might as well save all of the warp that's extra and use it on your next project. So you can see I'm just pulling it in until I've got about a few inches left on the one end, and then what I'll do is I will take and tie the surgeon's knot, you know, through the center and up once, and then over and through the center again, and pull up really hard, really, really hard, and really hard, really reef on that, and then just set this end aside. Don't cut it off yet. And now you can do the same thing with the second set of warp strands at the center. I have to find, there's the loose ends. Where's the peg? Here we go. Here's the peg, the second one. And so I'm going to do the same thing that I did with the first one. And I'm going to pull it up, and I'm going to be starting to make sure my number shows up there. Make sure that you leave enough ends there for your shaping and your knot tying. I could probably come a little bit further. Okay, and I'll do the same thing I did last time. Tie that surgeon's knot once and twice. Now, you're only going to tie that first half of the surgeon's knot. You're not going to tie the second half of a square knot, because the ends, that knot would sit like a lump always in your circle, and you couldn't ever disguise it. What you will do with your ends is you'll take them into a darning needle and you'll weave them all, you'll stitch them all inside, and they'll be buried and the circle will stay closed. Now, finding the, here's the third end. You can see where we've got it nice and dense and tight in the center. And I'm pulling up, where are my ends for the third one? Here we go. And each row does get progressively longer, of course, because you're working your way out. So kind of stretch and pull at it so that you do for sure have yourself shaping it into the circle. As you can tell, it's not very circular yet, but don't worry, it'll get there. Okay, and those ends need to be out of the way. Okay, and now I can tie off this one, the third one. You can also use your felting needles and felt more colors onto the circle. And in the last part of the video, I'm going to show a, there we go. I'm going to show a gallery of pieces that I've used circular circle motifs in, peg loom woven pieces that have circles in them. Now, with this is my fourth one. So you can tell now I'm starting to not have a whole lot of extra yarn at the in these outside edge pieces. So I need to kind of watch that I don't pull too far. You need to lift up your other ones. You don't want it to be ruffled, but you do want it to be pulled in. Okay, that's looking good. And see, there's quite a difference between this fourth one and the center one. At the center, there's hardly any warp used at all. So there's quite a lot of extra left. And by the time we get to the outside rows, There's not a lot extra. Okay, so we've got our surgeon's knot tied here. And here's our outside row. Look at that, there's hardly anything extra on either side. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to pull in the outside from one end to about halfway around, and then pull with the hook end, I mean the peg end, and then tie off this end, this side. And I'm going to have some ends to weave in, of course. Ugh, that's kind of snagged there. That's okay, I can trim it and trim and fix afterwards. I just have to ask my husband to let the dog out. Sweetie, can you let the puppy out, please? We have a puppy requesting to go out. Thanks, hon. Okay, so, and I do have the video camera on. Okay, so, it's not quite circular, so we'll keep working at it. So this is the other side, and you can see I've got ends that need to be woven in. And I'll take my hook after, and you can see I've got lots of loose ends that need to be woven in. And I will do that, and I'm going to cut my warp strands to release the pegs. And then I'm going to weave in the yarn ends into the channel. And then I will cover up where I wove them in. And you won't actually even be able to see, eventually, once that's all done, they will just be hidden completely. And this is why I love the latch hook so much, is that it's very quick for weaving in ends. Make sure I get all of the ends woven in. I'm going to weave in the weft ends separately from the warp ends. I just want to get those warp ends in first so that my shape is all I can kind of knead and squish it around to get it into the full circle. But you want to get your warp ends in. Oh, and I'm not having to trim my warp ends very much on the outside couple of rows, but of course I'm going to have to trim off quite a bit from the inner rounds, because they are, of course, there's lots of warp left over. But you can see that by weaving the ends in, see how that covers the surgeon's knot quite nicely? And then I'll use the tail ends to cover up. I'll use this to cover up anything that's gappy still in the center there. And it will come out quite circular. You'll be surprised. Okay, so here's my second outside row. think I'll I will weave these ends in. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to cut off my warp strands, and then I'm just going to keep on weaving in my ends into the channel. That's the row that I wove, is what I call the channel, so that I can get those ends all completely hidden and nudged into shape. So when I've got those all these ends woven in, I will come back. So there we go. A circle woven on the Dewberry Ridge peg loom. And we did use, or I used, five of the medium size pegs, which with this thickness of yarn gave me a circle of 7 inches in diameter. And it's, as you can see, it's, you know, there's sort of some wibbly wobbly parts, but it's close enough to be good enough for a circle. It's amazing how pulling in all your ends and weaving all your ends in does shape it into the circle. And I find that the that process of the pulling in and tightening and then weaving in the ends, it's kind of slow, and you can think of it as boring, but think of it more as a circle meditation. I will, in the last segment of this video, I'll take you for a bit of a walkabout in my studio and show you a couple of pieces that I have woven on the peg loom using circle motifs in them as part of my show of tapestries and other woven works called Woven Women. So that'll be the final segment of this video. So after you weave the circles on the peg loom, what can you do with them? Well, lots of the uses come to mind. This video is actually, I made this video in support of my pattern for my ebook, the patterns in my ebook, How to Weave Baskets on the Peg Loom. So if you go to my website and go to the stick weaving page, you'll find wonderful patterns for baskets and jewelry as well. But beyond baskets and jewelry, there's things like rugs, of course, carpets, and trivets, placemats, and art. So let me show you a few pieces that I've made with using circles woven on the peg loom. So the circle that I've been weaving in this video tutorial has become a mask. You can see that I have added beading and embroidery and spool knitted cords and lots of other wonderful things. So the circles can become many, many things. This woven circle that you can see up here, two-tone woven circle, I have combined with found objects. That's a holdfast, a seaweed root, plus driftwood, and a broken metal gear that my husband found on the beach, and a vintage star, and seaweed, and sea glass that's spool knitted into wire with hand spun and hand woven pieces. So that piece is called Stella Maris, because she's all about gifts from the sea. And again, using the circle in an interesting way. These pieces are all part of my solo show of woven tapestries and woven collages and montages.
So this circle I have combined with, again, with found objects, a wooden burl with beading and crochet and spool knitting, be a nature spirit. Again, beginning with the woven circle and then moving out from that. So this piece is called Flora in the Garden, and I wove this one. It's quite a big one. It's about a meter tall, a yard tall. And I wove this one on the peg loom. And you can see there's all kinds of woven circles on her that I've appliqued on to her. Lots of woven circles and some crocheted pieces as well. And mostly hand spun yarns, but some commercial yarns. So again, working with the circle motif. Oops, barking dogs. We have barking dogs. So there we have just a few pieces showing the things that, oh, you know what I didn't show too, is baskets. I should show you some of the woven baskets. Well, I have one that's close at hand here. I'll go get it and show it to you. So woven baskets are also wonderful ways to work with your circular motifs. And like I said before, the this video is in support of my patterns, my ebooks for making woven jewelry and baskets on the peg loom. So please support my videos by supporting my, by buying my patterns. So thank you very much and happy weaving. Go gently.